Good afternoon. Whilst the panel is getting ready, I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Gavin Yamey. I lead a new global health think tank called E2PI, the Evidence to Policy Initiative, in Sir Richard Feetcham's Global Health Group at the University of California, San Francisco. As the name suggests, E2PI works to help narrow the gap between evidence and action, and you can read more about our work at e2pi.org. So it really is my great privilege to moderate the first of two high-level roundtable discussions. Our one will look at priority setting for innovation and access. I was just talking to Dan over lunch, Dan Hartman, and he reminded me that priority setting really just means decision making. So we're going to be focusing on how decisions get made, and I hope that we'll heed Jim Kim's reminder that innovation doesn't just mean new technologies, it also means narrowing the gap between what we know and what we do. E2PI does we do a lot of work in global diarrhea policy, and it's just incredibly depressing. 800,000 children last year died under the age of five from diarrhea. They literally dehydrated to death. And we could probably have saved all of those kids with ORT zinc. It's been over 8 years since WHO and UNICEF called for universal access to that combination. And the latest demographic and health survey data suggests that less than 1% of children are receiving both drugs. So we have an urgent need to innovate in delivery as well. So before I introduce this truly high-level panel with some really great minds, MSF and DNDI has just asked me to set the scene very briefly for the discussions. I'm not an expert in this topic. I'm an interested observer. I used to be a reporter and a journal editor. I was at the BMJ and then at the Public Library of Science, PLOS, a truly radical open access publisher that believes that biomedical research publications should be a global public good. Fancy that. Not a commodity to be owned and sold by for-profit publishing companies. I think there's some interesting parallels with the open source drug discovery movement. And I wrote my first piece about neglected diseases about 10 years ago, an editorial in the BMJ. And back then I said that when it comes to the world's most neglected diseases, they present absolutely no market opportunities, and without those opportunities, there's no incentives for the pharmaceutical industry to invest in drug R&D. The patients have no purchasing power, there's no vocal group that's pleading for their needs, and there are simply no strategic interests, military interests, security interests, that are driving concern about these conditions. Now, that's as true today as it was 10 years ago, although clearly, as we've heard this morning, there has been a flurry of activities. Just to highlight a few from memory, this morning we heard about the advanced market commitment for pneumococcal vaccines. We heard about Gavi saving around 5 million lives. We've heard about product development, public-private partnerships, MMV, DNDI, technology transfers, South-South collaboration, prize funds, the medicines patent pool. Exciting times. The picture isn't as bleak as when I wrote that piece 10 years ago, and I called Mary Moran a couple of weeks ago to talk about the latest findings from Policy Cures and the GFinder project, which maps funding for R&D across the public, private, and philanthropic sectors. And she was tremendously excited with her latest data hot off the press suggesting 359 neglected disease products in the 2012 pipeline. That's diagnostics, vaccines, and drugs. But clearly, all is not well, as we will discuss in a moment. There are gaps, challenges, concerns. We heard about the latest DNDI MSF report on the pipeline showing continued critical R&D being neglected. We also know that the efforts to date have been around a relatively limited set of diseases, and I hope that this afternoon we'll broaden the discussion to other neglected conditions. These initiatives have largely relied on donor funding, mostly donor government funding, to some extent philanthropy, and GFinder has found something troubling. From 2009 to 2010, we started to see a downturn in donor funding. The New York Times recently had a piece about the golden decade of donor assistance for global health coming to an end. The writing appears to be on the wall. What are we doing about that? How are we finding new, sustainable ways to fund innovation and access? And finally, going beyond innovation, it strikes me that this is a patchwork set of activities. Is that really the best that we could do? Can we do better? Could we be bolder? Do these activities really get at the heart of the problem? John Arne Rottingen recently wrote a piece in PLOS Medicine in which he said that these efforts have treated the symptoms exhibited by the system failure and not really the root causes. And are these activities truly linked with needs? Do we have the right priority setting process? Are we listening to the voices of patients, the voices of suffering in defining R&D needs? So these are some of the very difficult questions, important questions that we'll be tackling this afternoon. I've encouraged all the five panelists to be bold and brave and not shy away from controversy. Perhaps even some news will be made this afternoon. You never know. Lord Northcliffe, the famous British press magnate, said that news is something that someone somewhere doesn't want you to say, and all the rest is advertising. Let's see if we make some news this afternoon. And in that spirit of bold inquiry, let me briefly introduce the panelists. From right to left, I think, as you look at the panel, Manika Balasagaram, who is standing in for Uni Karunakara, who has sadly lost his voice completely, is executive director of MSF's Access Campaign, was previously head of DNDI's Leishmaniasis Clinical Program, and also head of the Manson Unit. That's the research and implementation arm, the London-based arm of MSF. Rolake Odetoyinbo is the executive director and founder of PATA, the Positive Action for Treatment Access Nigerian NGO. She's an activist, writer, trainer, TV and radio producer. She's a graduate of the African American HIV University in LA and is an openly positive woman who works on HIV, disabilities, sexual and reproductive health. Dan Hartman directs integrated development in the Gates Foundation's Global Health Program, and he asked me to remind you that he's just joined 8 months ago. And yet, in 8 months, under his leadership, integrated development is working very closely with the foundation's strategy teams to manage product pipelines. He's got a very extensive history within the pharmaceutical industry, for example, at Decode Genetics, Pfizer, Esperion, Eli Lilly, and so on. Mary-Paul Keeney is Assistant Director General for Health Systems and Innovation at the WHO. Before that, she was ADG for Innovation, Information, Evidence, and Research. And before that, she directed the WHO Initiative for Vaccine Research. And last but not least, Carlos Godella is the Secretary of Science, Technology, and Strategic Supplies in the Brazilian Ministry of Health. He was at Fiocruz, the Oswaldo Cruz Foundation, for over 20 years, where he was Vice President of Production and Innovation in Health. So welcome to the panelists. I'm going to moderate a discussion that lasts something like an hour, and then I would really love to bring the audience in into the discussion. And we obviously have an extraordinary array of actors at this table, and I wanted to begin by thinking about and examining the role of these quite different constituencies when it comes to the priority setting process. And Mary-Paul, I would like to start with you and the WHO. In 2002, I wrote a piece for the BMJ somewhat provocatively titled, "Why Does the World Still Need the WHO?" But actually, in defense of the WHO, and it was a piece very much in praise of the WHO, despite the title, I said that as international health cooperation fragments, WHO's role in setting global standards has become crucial, and I think that's particularly true for priority setting. So I would like to ask you, Mary-Paul, what do you think WHO's role should be in setting global health priorities and in the R&D agenda sphere in particular?
Thank you very much. And I must say, the number of articles coming in the press saying, you know, is WHO still relevant and do we need WHO? And you know, it's a good question. But it's a good question to which, you know, many of the authors of the articles at the end say, yes, we need it, but we need it also to be better. Okay, let's see what we can do in the reform process that we have ongoing now for the organization. Well, for WHO, setting priorities is made on several factors, analyzing the situation and then making recommendations. So this is not something that WHO as a secretariat, because as I'm sure you know, there's two aspects of WHO. There's WHO is the member state organization, so all governments are part of WHO, and there's also the secretariat, which are the WHO staff, like myself and a few others that I see here. And so what the secretariat is really guiding the prioritization that the member states want to see, and they are informing this prioritization. So what we do usually, we convene panels of experts, and these experts traditionally in WHO need, and we want to have them coming from different culture, different areas, different, having also different competency, and look at the same time at the science to see what is possible, what is feasible, what is needed. And then we try to cross this and to cross check with what the countries need and want, with also what is called the disease burden. After this, we help these committees make recommendations, as these recommendations are there for everybody to grab them. So I was interesting, although I haven't heard Dan say that you said that Dan had said, thank you, Dan, priority setting is decision making. Well, for us, no. Because, you know, decision making means to have also money to implement then these decisions. We don't make decisions. We present recommendations, and we hope that these recommendations will be sufficiently convincing to have others who have the means to embrace these recommendations and these priorities.
And what steps are you taking to ensure inclusiveness in a sort of a truly democratic process with many voices at the table?
As I say, we try to cover different geographical location. We try also to have a balanced, as much as possible, representation of women and men, and therefore we try to avoid to only rely on expert opinion of panels of Anglo-Saxon males, as we see very often. Sorry.
No, sorry.
And then also we really look at the background of the experts. We are very careful in also examining whether their opinion, their recommendation that they would give to the organization is devoid of bias. They don't have any personal conflict of interest that would push them to propose one direction rather than another. This is the way it usually proceed. But of course, you know, prioritization needs information, needs evidence, and in the area of research and development for diseases of the poor, the so-called type 2, 3, and the special needs for type 1 diseases, there's a lot of uncertainty about what is really invested, what are the pipelines, and some initiatives like the G-Finder that you mentioned do a great job of doing this, but this is not by far covering what is happening everywhere. It is not covering in particular what's happening in middle income and low income countries.
And I think we'll return to needs assessment in a moment.
Yes.
Carlos, Brazil has been talked about many times this morning. What role do the emerging economies like Brazil, China, India, and so on, what role do they and should they play in setting priorities for needs-driven R&D?
First of all, let me Thanks a lot. The Doctors Without Borders and the NDI for the invitation. And I was prepared to speak in Portuguese, but I am a Latin person. And I think the way of saying sometimes is more important than the word, the simple word we say. Then I will talk to you in English to try to tell you all my perspective, personal perspective, and even the emotion with the process we are dealing. And nowadays, I think in the morning, I think it a lot. We must talk and think about different ways to deal with productive sector. This is the key part of the puzzle. Without the productive sector and with a new arrangement to deal with the productive sector, we will not advance a lot. This is the key point of the Brazilian policy and the key point I bring here to discuss with you. It's not only the public-private partnership, the classical one, that the public sector offered the services to the private sector, or even the advanced market commitment. You focus only in neglecting the disease. You must establish a more broad relationship, establishing a way of dealing with public priorities and the private one. I think that it's almost, how can I say, I think that I'm always saying that. The health authority must coordinate industrial and technological policy. We are doing that in Brazil, and if you don't do that, we will not advance a lot because the technology policy and the industrial policy will be out of the social and the health needs. I think this point is very important. And the public-private partnership or productive partnership must be broad. For example, in benzonidazole, we add in the same partnership drugs for neurological system, drugs that has profit and that private firms are interested, but we tell them, we only establish this partnership if we develop the benzonidazole in Brazil. The same in the vaccine. All our vaccine program is based in this kind of partnership. We have the most advanced vaccines, expensive vaccines in our program, and the more rotating vaccines that have been produced for a long time. For example, this permit that 2 weeks ago, we announced that we will begin to produce HPV vaccine with a low price in Brazil, in the global market. This is a challenge that we are facing nowadays. Then this first words is that we must think a new way to establish this cooperation. It's not easy, it must be a win-win game, but it's not only do a little more of the same. Give a little more money, give a little more stimulus, give a little more ways to please help the poor people. We must face the real problem of the world asymmetries in terms of technology, innovation, and the health access. We must face it, and I think that Brazilian experience, only it's not marketing, but it's only an experience of a country that is trying to put together the social policy with the economical policy. This is, and in the health, we are obliged to do that. We must give the example. Then, to begin our conversation, I think this is the general idea I'd like to
Fantastic, thank you very much. I'm going to return to Brazil in a minute. Rolake, building on Lucy's comments from this morning, and as a patient activist and advocate, do you see shortcomings in the way in which priorities in global health are being set? How do you view that process of what gets prioritized or what gets decided upon?
I think we've come some way, and it's interesting to watch us dance 2 steps forward and 1 step backwards. And I'm going to use the example of WHO. Do we need WHO? Sure, we need WHO. If we didn't have WHO, I wonder what countries like mine would do. And if you look at WHO 10 years ago, it was just some people in coats who would sit around the table and make some decisions and send it down to country level, which is very different from what WHO is today, where the way treatment guidelines are made, the consultative process, it's so different. And even looking at the way that is done, you can see the difference on the ground, because then people can take ownership and say, well, this is what we'd like to have. Another example would be the Global Fund. When I used to be, very first time I was on that delegation in 2004, was when, as communities of people living with HIV, that was when we got our voting rights. It was the first time we were allowed to actually vote on issues that affect our lives. And it was the most, that board meeting, I think, everybody wept like a baby, because like, oh, finally we can make decisions. And then it looked like the party had started, and you know, you felt good at that table because you had to lobby, you had to do what everybody else had to do. Today, unfortunately, the Global Fund is donor-driven. I'm sorry, Lucy. But that's just the truth of, sadly, the way things have moved. So you can see some places where it used to be bad and then now it's good. Other places, it used to be great and now. But bottom line really is, when those things happen, why do you have that process? I think it's because countries have not stepped up to the plate. It's because for as long as we rely on international aid, then we will not set our own priorities. Then we'll be donor dependent, and they will make all those decisions. But at country level, it's a different thing. And the same way you have the good and the bad, the good example is a national HIV plan, national strategic plan for HIV and AIDS, where everybody is at the table, and you have the consultations, as opposed to the national health plan, which is a bigger one. And there it's just the same thing, men in suits, sit down, write this thing and send it out, nobody owns it. And you can see that difference. So in terms of how priorities are set, I think we have good examples, we have bad examples. And it's determined really by who has the purchasing power and who's...
Are there opportunities, more opportunities, better opportunities, out of the box opportunities to get patients' voices heard more at the table?
Interesting, Gavin, that's not a word I like very much when you say patience. And every time I had that thing earlier on with Lucy, I cringed. I'm like, okay.
That reflects my medical training, I'm sorry. My biomedical bias.
Yeah, I mean, I was tempted to say when Lucy was speaking, hey, she's more than a patient. She's an advocate and she runs an organization and she's a researcher and she's all of these things. But oh, yes, we do use those services and we are patients in the hospital. So is there a better way to get our voices and our inputs? Definitely, yes. But then the question is, do you really want our voices and our inputs? And that's the question I've asked lots of times. Do you really, really want my opinion? Or do you just want to put me on that seat so that I can echo whatever you want me to say? And even when you can see that, and that happens a lot, you know, when...
I think that's a point very well taken, yeah. And well appreciated.
No, not to you. You know, if you had done that to me, I'd have told you to get off my case, not to you. But even that happens when, you know, say you, there is a big meeting like this one now, and, oh, Rolake, I put your name forward because I think you'll do a good job. And, you know, I think you should say this and what. I think they need to hear. You're thinking, okay. You didn't have to bring me all the way from Lagos, Nigeria. You could have well brought somebody else, put them here, and just say everything you want said. That's one way of doing it. Unfortunately, I think we haven't learned, not we haven't, there is still this divide of the North and the South, and some people believe they have all the answers, and they need to feed you with those answers so you can regurgitate whatever it is they, you can vomit whatever it is they have told you to say. So that's not a good way of doing it. But a good way of doing it is really empowering me with the right information, opening up those spaces and unleashing me. If you believe that I'm in good stead and you think I really know what I'm doing, which means I have learned, I'm sorry, that's my alarm. It says I just take my medications. So if you've done that, then it means you will trust whatever comes out of my mouth because it's really my own issue and you trust me with that. So that's one good way of doing it. But it means you really have to back off and trust my trifling, sentimental, scientific opinion.
I like that map that Carlos showed with the south at the top and the north at the bottom. Manika, MSF is a humanitarian assistance organization. It delivers assistance in the field. What on earth was it doing? What was it thinking when it got into this space, this R&D activism space, this access to medicine space?
I mean, I think there's very little I can say that hasn't been said before on this. I mean, we all know that more than a decade ago, what the situation was. Our patients were dying in the field. We didn't have treatments for HIV, for malaria, for a whole range of different diseases. When I was working in Uganda more than a decade ago, we didn't have ARVs to treat our patients. We were using chloroquine to treat malaria. I was using malasprol to sleep sickness. So it was a very bad situation. So it was very normal, I think, for an organization that was very driven around what people needed and what it was seeing in the field to actually take some action on that. And I think if we now reflect on what's happened in the last 10 years, I think, well, yeah, that has been there has been progress made, but I also still feel that there's still a huge amount of gaps. And I also feel that we're living in this global health community that is very kind of self-congratulatory in the way it behaves on this. I think we know what the problems are. There was a presentation earlier by Joanna and also the presentation on an update on that fatal imbalance report. It shows that, again, in these areas of neglected diseases, we still basically see the same issues, we still see the same gaps. We talk about TB, we still basically see we don't have the right tools for treating drug-resistant TB, we don't have the right vaccines adapted to the needs where we're working on. So I really ask the question, I mean, what the hell has really changed? We're putting, you know, piecemeal solutions to each problem, and then there's another problem that pops up. And is this the way we're going to continue working for the next decade? Well, this doesn't seem to me like a global health community and a global health response. I would actually say that what's global is that we all think the same way. We all look at our interests and our silos that we're working in, and we're not able to see the bigger picture. And even when the bigger picture is handed to us in a plate, like it was done earlier today by John Arner, and presented to decision makers, we don't move forward with that. And that's after 10 years of going through a very consultative process. And for me, of course, I feel a sense of anger about it because, you know, I really don't think we have moved very, very far. I mean, I think there has been, whatever progress has been made, to me, it's just expected that we will have to make some progress. Otherwise, we're going way back, we're going in reverse. And I'd like to throw this thought out for you. I mean, I was looking at the example on tuberculosis, and you look, there's a really rich pipeline coming out there. But there are drugs now being registered for this. So that's great. That really is good news after 50 years of nothing. But is there going to be a treatment we can operationalize and scale up tomorrow, or 1 year from now, or 2 years from now, or even 5 years from now? I doubt it, right? So what's going to change for all those people who are sitting, you know, with drug-resistant TB now and in the next few years? Well, nothing, right? And then, and even if you say, well, things might get better, we'll have new drugs on the pipeline. Well, we're still coming back from reverse in that sense. We lived in an era, you know, not that long ago, where we had 6-month treatment courses for TB, and that cured most people, right? We had pretty good cure rates on that. Now, what happened? We developed drug-resistant TB, so now we're really happy that we're developing drugs that is going to take us back where we were 10, 15 years ago. Well, what's so fantastic about that in terms of progress? So we have quite a long way to go in terms of actually developing something completely groundbreaking in treating TB as something that would be something of the past in terms of a public health issue. And I think we need to bear that in mind when we look at things like what the R&D framework is really about. It's about having a sustainable model that's going to take us forward for the next few decades, irrespective of what the disease is, irrespective of what the problem is, because there will always be gaps, and we have to anticipate what those gaps are. Anyway, I don't think there's more to say in that, because I think these things are, to me, they're fairly self-evident. All the problems have been presented in a very clear way, even in this draft resolution that came out from the member state meeting, presented these problems in a very clear way, but didn't come up with any kind of solid solutions. So I'll end my rant there. I'm in a bit of a bad mood because
MSF has been a very strong advocate of open source innovation, open source drug discovery. Yeah. I think PLOS has been a bit of a partner in that because PLOS seems to be publishing many of the think pieces from MSF and DNDi and others. What do you think the promises of those kinds of open sources approaches might be?
Well, I think it's just a fundamental point that was made earlier today, and that's this issue about delinkage. I think we need to look at a whole range of solutions, that being one of them, that can help us achieve delinkage. And why is that important? As just as a principle. I think it's because when we talk about innovation, it's a really fundamental issue. It's not about coming up with a new chemical entity or a new treatment or a new diagnostic. It's about changing the way we work and having a public health impact. And that should be the driver of our community, of the research and development community. And if it's not, you have to ask yourself the question, why? And we have to have principles. That's really important. We have to be principled in the way we're thinking, the way we're behaving, and the way we set up our system, because that's how we will meet public health interests.
Dan, the Gates Foundation, big player, obviously, in global health advocacy, communications, policy, delivery, and R&D. GFinder found just over $1 billion of R&D for neglected diseases between 2007 and 2010, so a big portfolio. I wonder if you could share with the audience the Gates Foundation's thinking on priority setting for R&D. Because Dan is new, I have allowed to the foundation just 8 months. I've allowed him a few slides, but he's only going to take three or five minutes.
Three to five
to show you the Gates Foundation's view on priority setting.
Thank you. So 3 to 5. When you give you that range, it's always 5. It's like, how long is it going to take to develop this program? Probably 4 to 6 years. Has anybody ever seen a 4 to 6 year program coming at 4 years? So, no. So anyway, count 5. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here and get to use my new guy card one more time. I do want to talk a little bit about how we're thinking at the Gates Foundation, try to be as transparent as possible. This slide comes from a recent foundation leadership team and our CEO. And really, it's all about impact. And so when we think about priorities, we're really focusing on impact. We look at it from a couple of different ways. We look at our own resources, and we have headcount, we have money. Those are the typical resources that we think about. We look at our grantees and our partners, and you know, we're not, as many of you know, we're really not passive donors, so this is a two-way arrow, as are all of these. So we recognize that for us to have the greatest impact, we really need to focus on what are we doing and try to work with our grantees and partners to get the most impact. I included this slide just to, there's a couple things on here. So one, if you look at the global health budget here, that's a pretty real number. It's almost $2 billion. And if you look at what happened from 2010 to 2011, you've seen a pretty big increase. So I think that's great. I think it's also important to realize, and we certainly realize, that we are a modest to small component of the overall global health financing, and actually, if you think about the overall financing, we're actually a small component. The other thing I just want to point out is, you know, if you look at what's happened at the budget of the foundation since its inception, over the last 12 years, it's been a very steep climb, both in terms of headcount and in terms of budget. And I think for the foreseeable future, we've kind of hit this plateau where we're leveling out. So we're, I hate to use the word resource constrained, but we're trying to think really hard about how we use our resources for impact. So this is why I wanted to have the slides, because it's really hard to explain this without a slide, and even with a slide, it's probably hard to understand. would anybody like to try? No, I'll try to simplify this as much as possible. On our y-axis, we have what I would call healthcare impact. And here we're looking at, you know, dollars per dally. We're looking, you know, the highest impact that we can have. This is really where we want to be. And I think that's pretty understandable. You know, you want to have the most impact for the money. On this axis, PTRS is probability of technical and regulatory success. So if we have limited resources, which we do, which everybody does, there's not an infinite amount of money, I don't care what area you're working in, we really need to think about how are we spending the resources that we have. So, you know, we spend a lot of time thinking about what's the probability of having something. So it's not just about doing something. It's not about running a study. When did you get your first patient in, your last patient out? What's the pipeline look like? It's what's that pipeline going to produce? So we spend a lot of time, and I can go into much greater detail about all the different components that go into this, but needless to say, we're using a lot of Bayesian statistics, mathematics, looking at the mechanism of action, what can we learn about the diseases, a whole host of different components come in, and we actually come up with a number. So the way it used to be done in a lot of different areas, including pharma, is you'd ask the team and say, okay, well, do you think this is going to work? Do you think your product is going to work? Of course it will, you know? And so we tended to inflate these, and I think we're coming up with a much better system to understand that. The third component here is the orthogonality component. In certain cases, the Gates Foundation goes after things that other people won't. So people, you know, look at Bill and Melinda and they go, wow, with all these resources, why don't you fund Alzheimer's? You know, or, you know, type 2 diabetes is a huge issue. It's a big global issue. Why don't you do that? Well, there's other people playing in that space. So, you know, I think if you think about impact, probability, and other people not playing in the space, then you get a general idea of what that looks like. In terms of how we set our strategies, and this is my last slide, I'm probably about 4 minutes. We set our strategies, our disease area teams work with some of our other technical teams to set strategies designed to focus on impact. We develop what we call quantitative target product profiles, and this is something that we'll be doing more and more of going forward because we think it's important for impact. And they say, you know, if we had a product like this, we could have this type of impact. Well, we come up with strategies and plans that will inform this quantitative target product profile. We look at efficacy and safety targets, both today and what the landscape will look like. It tends to be relatively constant unless the landscape changes. And so another word for saying it's rather ruthless. And we look at kind of what's the minimal acceptable hurdle that we look at. And we also, I think it's important just to say here, we're looking at delivery. We're not just saying, okay, it has to have this efficacy, because if you have to take it 6 times a day or the cold chain, I mean, all of these different components are going in up front. So a lot of the patient, for lack of a better word, what do people want? What are they going to take? ORS, people aren't taking it. Why are they not taking it? We're trying to think of these things up front. We go out, we generate data. That data comes back, goes into our equations, and it comes up with what's the probability of meeting that. And that's just one of the ways that we can make go-no-go decisions. So there's a pretty systematic way that we're doing that. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I wanted to push you a little bit on the Gates Foundation's view of R&D priorities and the broader priority setting process that Mary-Paul and Relake, Carlos, Manika have talked about, a broader process involving multi-stakeholders, involving affected communities, WHO member states, emerging economies, NGOs, and so on. How does the Gates Foundation's thinking on setting priorities for R&D fit with that broader process, or do you see yourselves as kind of going it alone?
Well, I'll answer the last question first because that's the easiest one. So we're not looking to go alone. I think that's pretty clear. You know, when you look at priorities, again, I try to look at the data, try to think about the decision-making process that goes into it. I think you can come up with a whole host of meaningful priorities or meaningful targets to fund. I think the difficulty is trying to make the decision about what that priority will be. You know, if you look at the U.S. today, you know, do we raise taxes or cut entitlements? You know, and you can see how easily that decision's being made in Washington. You know, so I think we do need to think about those things. Part of the data that we look at is, you know, what are our partners thinking? What are they doing? How are they looking at this? Do they have insights that we don't have? Yeah, and I think that's really, you know, to try to make such difficult decisions, understanding the consequences of what those decisions will be, both on the positive and the negative side, you really do need to pull as much information as you can together and try to understand it. You know, looking at, you know, some things are facts, some things are not. And I think in the global health space, we have numbers, but we also have error bars. And we have to recognize that, you know, just because you have a mean number or an estimated number, sometimes the error bars around those can be substantial. And so we need to think about, you know, what if it's on this side or that side of the error bar, and take that into account as we're thinking about priorities.
Thank you. I want to return to this notion of financing and sustainable financing and where future financing is going to come from. And perhaps we should start with the open-ended member states draft resolution, which does not now have a binding treaty. And Mary Paul, without that binding treaty, I would be interested to know, is this draft resolution a glass half full, as John Arne thinks it might be, or a glass half empty? What do we have left without this promise of sustained financing? What will the observatory do? What will some of these other functions do that will move the game forward?
Sorry, when I heard that John Arne said that it was a glass half full, so I wouldn't want to contradict him. He agreed, it's a glass half full. What the member states really wanted to do is to have us, they wanted to have an approach by different stages, and they very consciously decided to take one step after the other. So this is not to say that they will not and they are not ready to put more money than what was on the table. This is not to say that they will not agree of creating a pooled voluntary fund, but they want to have a better grip of what would be these priorities, so what is actually the situation. And also because the member states, as I'm sure you realize, many of these member states are actually representing developing countries or middle and low income economies. And therefore, they also need and want to know what is happening in their countries, in their regions, in order to see really what priorities should be made. So the decision was as you've seen on the draft resolution, to start with establishing an observatory that would really put the data and information about flow of resources, about product pipelines, about infrastructure, about capacity in terms of researcher, in terms of startup company in certain countries, and have an accurate landscape of what are the needs, what are the financial flow, what are the opportunities. Based on that, they would be then ready to go and for a second step. Now, again, coming to a treaty, there's also, it was not really debated as such, because I think everybody was aware of the fact that a treaty with no signatory, or a treaty in which all the resource contributors usually would not be party, would be of little benefit to push this agenda forward. And this is why there was a consensus at the end to move with voluntary funding first.
Are you optimistic about voluntary funding? That's not a loaded question.
Well, yes, because there is money coming on that. The United States, as was repeated several times, and also by the CWG, is the only country which is meeting the targets set by the CWG in terms of funding research and development for poor countries. Others are very far behind. Now, we are in a situation which is also not the best time, I think, to really discuss lots of new financing, because you have a traditional donors who are facing a financial crunch, and therefore the main objective is to save money. And then you have the middle-income countries, the BRICS country in particular, who don't see themselves as donors yet. Yes, to a certain degree, bilateral assistance is given by Brazil, for example. But they don't see themselves on the part of a table which is providing money for others. And then we are still in a situation where the low-income country, even if the recommendation of the CWG was to provide 0.01% of the GDP, and if you have a very low GDP, it means really, really very little money. There's an immediate reaction saying, oh, not us, they pay. So as long as we are not in a situation where everybody contributes, and this is what the CWG really recommended, this is a joint responsibility, a common responsibility of all rich and poor.
And I want to ask Carlos and Dan about this. Carlos, Peter Hotez and John Arnie and now Mary Paul have all talked about the role of the emerging economies like Brazil in stepping up on R&D investments. How would you respond to that?
I answer you very clearly. I don't think that we must wait for the Biden convention. I'm for it. But we have all the ways to act now. I don't think that we may wait for more 5 years discussing. We have 10 years of experience or more, 20 years. We have many ways to do things. In Brazil, for example, in an action together with Cuba, offer vaccine to meningitis crisis in Africa, donate it, avoiding a terrible problem in Africa, creating a belt around the disease. This product of artesunate mefloquine, ASQM, was donated the technology to Asia. Then we have many concrete actions that cost money, that implies an action that we are doing now. With Gates Foundation, we have a new pattern of cooperation. I'm very honest with you, and I want to stimulate the debate. In the beginning of the cooperation, there was a package. This is our package. We have a very good interaction with Gina, who is here, and we create, a cooperative program that we not only accept the package, but we construct, we build the action together, and we will launch the program together with Gates Foundation. It's not only some algorithm that we have to follow to see if the project is good or not. We have a joint commitment and a joint action. Then, how can I say, nowadays, global health is in our agenda. We think that we must act now. There is no excuse to wait more. There is no excuse. And we are completely open to contribute to global funds to help this action. But there is no excuse not to do. I mean, looking to my friends of DNDI, they saw that when the world stopped producing benzonidazole, Brazil was the only one that assumed the responsibility to produce, to offer, and to give, for free, to give freely for countries that need it. It is last year and this year. This year we have no problem with the product. Then I think we have to take care with the problem of the Biden convention. It is very important. It is a good debate, but it is not an excuse stop or that restrict our concrete action in the current moment.
Thank you. Dan, on the Gates Foundation, again, GFinder data suggests a kind of a leveling off in commitments from the foundation in the foreseeable future. One thing Bill has and the foundation has is leverage and convening power and so on. And I'd be interested in your views on that. One of the things that was talked about this morning is, could the Gates Foundation be doing more to get others to step up to the plate?
Sure. No, I mean, we look at our money as really being catalytic. You know, as I mentioned, you know, it's a significant amount of money, but if you look at the overall pool, it's small. So I think the whole concept of trying to be catalytic, of trying to be, you know, especially Bill and Melinda being leaders out there, trying to get other philanthropies to join the game, as well as just using the brand to influence a variety of different people. I mean, I think that's one of, if you look at the headcount that we have in places like advocacy as well as R&D, I mean, we have a very significant advocacy group, and I think that's one of the things where we can play a significant role, and we try to play a significant role.
I'd like to talk about some of the unaddressed priorities. I mentioned diarrhea earlier, something dear to our heart at the Global Health Group. Pneumonia, the biggest childhood killer, the growing explosion of non-communicable diseases, with most poor people now living in middle-income countries and not low-income countries, and facing a catastrophic burden of stroke, diabetes, heart disease. I don't see a sense of urgency around access issues or innovation issues for those diseases, and I'd love to get the panel's thoughts on that. Relake, from the activism in the HIV/AIDS world, the amazing experience in affecting the scientific process, in advocacy, you know, in urgency. What do you think the lessons from that movement might be that we could apply to some of these other priorities that we could potentially address?
If I'm going to think from the country level, when I used to be in love with MSF, and I fell in love with them working in AIDS in Nigeria, because, I mean, one of the things, great things that was done when they set up the very first treatment program then, the agenda was to prove that we could do AIDS treatment, and it could be comprehensive treatment. And it was done with advocates, and you had meaningful kind of research, like what is the real cost of treatment? So what does it cost me to go pick up my pill? Yes, the pills are free, but what is there a cost to me? And would have, like, the access campaign. So they had great things that truly involved, I could see my life in this, and I knew it wasn't just about this clinic, it's about what affects my life. So getting in on that program, you realize it's really me fighting for my life and willing to do all I know to ensure that that program succeeds, you know. So if you look at a model like that, and in terms of how does this affect, what's the science, what have we learned from this? What you've learned from it is that the only way to get things done is ensuring that those who are really affected are at that table, and that you carry them along from the beginning, not when you're in trouble, you're not looking for who will bail you out, you know, carrying them along from the beginning. I learned HIV treatment. The very first place I learned it was the Treatment Action Campaign in South Africa. And then TAC was working closely with MSF. I remember at some point I left the Cape Town office to go to Khayelitsha, because really that's where the action was. It wasn't sitting in Cape Town. And that's where I learned treatment literacy before I went to the African American, to the Black AIDS Institute in California. And these are groups who are doing great work, because what they're doing is teaching laymen the science that will change their lives. And it's programs like this, I think, that we really need to concentrate on and to fund. ITPC will give grants, and we have given grants in across developing countries to do treatment literacy. Because, you know, it doesn't matter how much you spend on pills. It doesn't matter how much these pills cost you. It's money down the drain. If I don't pop them, if I don't eat these drugs, then all your money is in vain. So it's, what then do we need to do to ensure that if there is if things aren't going well, people who are affected can raise their voices, generate demand, and ensure people stay in treatment.
You know, as you were talking, you reminded me of a tremendous NGO in Bangladesh, the Bangladesh Rural Advancement Committee, who is working on diarrhea. I don't know if anyone from BRAC is here educating patients about oral rehydration therapy and zinc, and actually reaching more people with health services now than the government is reaching. So there may be some interesting parallels. Monica, MSF, why aren't you out there advocating for some of these diseases that we talked about, or for a heat-stable insulin, or for a cheap polypill with aspirin or beta blocker or statin? Why not these neglected priorities?
I think we're asking us, internally as an organization, we're asking ourselves the same questions. I think what we are gradually seeing is an evolving picture. The problems that we faced yesterday are not necessarily the problems we're going to face in the next decade. And it's interesting now, increasingly, we are having the challenges to decide how we're going to operationalize X, Y, and Z. They're not easy questions to ask, especially since it's becoming increasingly expensive to operationalize anything these days. So I think that we have to, I think that that's still a critical question for us. I think, you know, if you look at the realm of non-communicable diseases, of cancer and so on, there's, I think, a huge amount of work now to address this, what we're seeing as a double burden of disease in many countries that has been addressed by several people earlier today. But I think, you know, for me, I think increasingly what we are going to find is we're evolving into a picture where increasingly even MSF is working in a lot of countries that, you know, 2 decades ago they weren't necessarily working in. If you look at also where our big TB programs are, they're in the Central Asia region. So I think we are going to be finding ourselves working in situations and working and responding to issues, and we are going to have to answer these questions. I think that's the challenge for us. But I think that the thing that really concerns me is that as we are now starting to enter all these different areas, are we going to have to face the same challenge every single time? If we start doing something now much more into DRTB, we start doing something to hepatitis C, et cetera, into non-communicable diseases, into diabetic care. And I think this is why increasingly in an environment where resources are scarce in the global health environment, these are pertinent questions. And it's very, I was so surprised to hear what Murray Paul said. I understood what you meant, that it's a really tough time now for member states to have this discussion. But this is, there never has been a better time to have this discussion. We have to be talking about these issues now. We have to be understanding how we can make a buck go that much faster, much further. And I think that the problem is we are paying for it now anyway. If you've seen the public investment for research anyway, it's huge. If you see what we have to pay for the cost of treatments and drugs, it's huge, especially since there isn't this concept of delinkage. We have to often pay very high prices for diagnostics and drugs. So we're paying for it anyway. So shouldn't we basically start thinking about a way of doing this a little bit better, specifically in an area where there are already identified gaps? Shouldn't we be basically thinking that also we should be setting the priorities, we should be setting what the target product profiles are for these gaps? It just seems to make sense, and it's almost surprising that for me, and from a very naive point of view, maybe that we can't see this huge potential, I think, to actually save resources and make the impact of what we're trying to do go that much further. So that for me is still the fundamental question. I mean, it's funny, I entered MSF to be a doctor working in the field, and this is where I've ended up. I asked myself the question. I started getting involved in clinical trials in the field. Why is MSF doing this? How the hell did we get involved in this? I was the last person in my class that anyone would have thought would be involved in research. And you know, I ended up doing 10 years worth of clinical trials. And that's, for me, we are still in this sorry state of affairs. We are still thinking as an organization, oh, how are we going to develop, you know, the kind of responses we are, and what are the investments we're going to have to make? And that, to me, still means we're still facing a fundamental issue that needs to be addressed on a bigger level.
Mary Paul, would you like to respond to that?
Yes, of course. You know, I agree with you. This is the time, and I agree also with what you said, is that the time to act is now, and we need to push the things forward now. We need also to, there is a sensible bit of money available, and also we need to see how we can how we can engage different partners also in the R&D enterprise. You can see, for example, what was described by Dan to set target product profile, and you mean this also. And we've seen in WHO for in a few instances, but if you try really to consult the people who would need it, the expert, and you can define a target product profile for something that would be cheap and accessible for developing countries, and you put it there, you try to say, you know, this is what we're looking for. You have people who come and say, well, maybe I can make something like that. And if you engage with them without money, you can help develop something that can be then transferred, the technology can be transferred to producers in this country to make it. We are working on a model for a diagnostic for diabetes, for example, which seems to work quite well. What we are looking for to address the question of non-communicable diseases, we are looking for many of these diseases as something which does not request really a Nobel Prize in terms of innovation. There are models which exist, they are just too expensive. So it's a question of trying to see how they can be designed to be simpler and less expensive, which is also, by the way, something that many of the high-income countries will look forward very much these days, because the cost of treating chronic diseases will soon become unbearable for everybody. So changing the way of driving innovation, thinking also of innovation as something which is maybe not the Rolls Royce, but something which is solid, which meets the need and meets the need of the people who will use them, is also something that can help us while there is not immediately an enormous amount of money more invested that can help continue to lead the innovation forward.
And as someone at MSF said to me recently, if we think the battles over access to antiretrovirals were contentious, wait for the battles over access to hypertensive drugs and diabetic drugs and cancer drugs, boy. It was just a warm-up for what's ahead, which is perhaps another reason why we need to think much more boldly and more radically about a new kind of system. Dan, I very just quickly wanted to ask you about the Gates Foundation and some of these other priorities. As you know, in 2008, The Lancet, fantastic journal, it's not open access, but it's a great journal, and I'm actually working on a Lancet commission right now, so I have to be careful, published a trio of pieces, a study, an editorial, and a commentary by Bob Black, in which clearly they praised the foundation as a game changer, but also pointed out that there's some huge priorities that are not on your portfolio: non-communicable diseases, pneumonia, diarrhea, nutrition. That's 4 years ago, and I wondered if the foundation had taken that critique to heart and was thinking differently about those conditions, or is that not on your plate?
That's a good question. So I think that. When I read that article, I think a couple of comments. So one, I think it was a good try. I think it was a good effort with the data that they had available to them. When I looked at what they tried to do with the data and the data that they had, I think, and they rightfully said that these results should be interpreted with caution. And I think that's probably the right conclusion. I think that they did make some very interesting points, and a lot of those I think that we have taken to heart. I mean, they commented in there about the number of grants that we had with WHO, and I think they were at 69 or something like that. I think we're well over 100, which, we can't do that. I mean, that's not a wise use of our money. Not that giving WHO is not a wise use, but doing it 100 different times, going through the administrative hassle every time we do that is not wise. I think the other thing that they talked about was transparency, and I think this is an area that we want to become more transparent. We want to put our strategies out there. We want to engage with other people to inform those strategies. We want to think about what is the product that's going to make the difference. Nobody wants to work on something, nobody wants to spend effort and money on something that's actually not going to be used. So our goal is not to get a registered product or a registered intervention, it's really to drive that through. So I think that's a component that we also looked at. Another comment in there was on the area of diagnostics, and I heard that brought up a bunch of different times today.
And I think that is an area that we are starting to look at more, and I think an area that we probably could do more in. And in fact, the diagnostic component of the Gates Foundation is within my group. Back when the article was published, we didn't have a diagnostics group. We do have one now, and we're actually starting to increase the emphasis on what they're doing. And I think there, you know, one of the key things that we're doing is we're actually going out and saying, what do we need in the field? You know, we can't put a $20,000 machine that needs its own air conditioning unit to function where we want to treat and help patients. So, you know, I think we are making a lot of progress in those areas. So I think, you know, some of the things that we were in there, we looked at just the area of non-communicable diseases. I think it's fair to say, and we've been reasonably transparent, it's not an area that we're targeting right now. And I think if you remember kind of the Z-axis that I talked about, it's really, we have, there's no innovation on the R&D side needed. I think perhaps maybe if we could innovate on how to manufacture them less, but I think it's going to be a delivery and a cost issue.
Thanks very much. So I've left about 20-25 minutes for questions. We wanted to make these roundtables as participatory as possible. So if you could line up at the mics, please let us know who you are before you ask your question. That would be great. Thanks. Yeah. Go ahead. Yes, do. I'm blinded by the light.
Blinded by the light.
There's a voice out there.
Yeah, I'm Rowan Gillies. I'm a previous MSF and D&DI functionaire. Just a little question. I was recently in Monrovia, where ASAQ is available, and I'd like to thank D&DI for all the work to get that available. Unfortunately, there's a lot of children still dying there of malaria, because in the government hospital system and the whole health system, there's no appropriate early referral. People have to pay for their medications, and often the medication is not available because the supply chain is no good. And I think this is one of the problems. I think the situation is actually a bit worse than what Monica says, because in the MSF world, all those things are sorted out, and all you need is the tool. But in the real world, for many, many patients outside of HIV, because there's two classes of patients. There's HIV patients, and then there's everyone else in a lot of public health hospitals, because there's free care, and it's available, much more available than for other things. So what I'd like to ask, especially Gates, when we talk about delivery, is that what's the next step? Because even by the time Monica is happy, which may never happen, with all the drugs available, there'll still be millions and millions of people who won't get that kind of care because the delivery system, there's been no innovation in the way to get medications from the port into the patient's mouths equitably and without too much cost to the patient.
Thanks. Dan, would you like to take that?
Yeah. So I am the Director of Integrated Development, and I'm happy to say that as we went through our restructuring or reorganization, we actually have kind of the other component of my work is integrated delivery. So these are two new departments at the Gates Foundation. I think we recognize that to have additional technical R&D capacity and thinking would be advantageous, but we're also thinking end-to-end and thinking about delivery, and we're looking at a variety of different ways to, you know, have a delivery component really right at the beginning of our thinking. We're looking at innovative ways to have development work with delivery. You know, I've been exposed just, you know, thinking over the last month of different things that we've looked at, ways to reduce cost of things like monoclonal antibodies, which wouldn't even be a concept in the global health world, but we could potentially reduce the cost of those by 50-fold, which would allow them to not have cold chain. We've thought about ways to deliver them without a cold chain. So, I mean, these are all things that we're actively looking at, and I think you'll hear more from the foundation as the integrated delivery department and division starts to get ramped up.
Anyone else on the panel wanted to respond to that?
If I can just add on that, yes, absolutely, you're right. You know, in the health systems do not for the time being, allow the effective delivery of services to many patients. There is a lot of verticalization, and you have the HIV track, you have malaria track, you have the EPI track, and those who are not in those are left with nothing. But there is also a fantastic momentum now in favor of universal health coverage, and I think everybody and the countries understand that they need to have something in place. Even the rich country where there was nothing understand that something must be done, and it is not possible and to let people in need of treatment without it. It's a question of human rights. And countries more and more are coming and are asking us in WHO to help and to help them design some kind of social protection that would cover everybody. So of course, you know, universal health coverage is not everything for everybody at whatever cost. It is to start with a package. It is to do correctly health technology assessment to see what is in the package and what is not in the package. And then when moving forward, then to try to enlarge the package. And to do this also, you need to have the elements of the work of health services working better together and integration of service delivery for both chronic and infectious diseases. But as I said, there is really a momentum right now. There has been a resolution passed at the UN on universal health coverage yesterday, I think, and many countries see that at potentially the new goal for the post-2015. Let's see.
Let's take two questions, one here and then the first person over there.
I'm Marcia Glass. I'm medical faculty at UCSF, and I've done field work with MSF. And I actually have a related question after working in Monrovia as well. We've heard from the Bill Gates Foundation and WHO about addressing the access issue. I specifically have the same question for MSF. Will we be able to affect a paradigm shift where on entering a country, we have an exit strategy immediately, not in the last week when we close a project or the last month, but the first day, so that we don't just vacate the most highly qualified healthcare professionals from all the public health positions and pay them five times what they would ever make for the government so that they'll never go back. And we don't partially treat patients who will then have nowhere to go when we pull out of the country. Is that something that we're now talking about? Have we learned from past mistakes, specifically Liberia, where 5 years later I've gone back and the same patients have nowhere to go who used to be treated by MSF?
And let's take a second one and then Monica will come back to you.
Hi there, Jennifer Chow with Research America. This is a great panel, thank you guys very much. We do USG advocacy, and so, you know, to Dan's point about needing delivery more than, say, innovation for R&D, I wonder how your comments about how USG advocacy would fit into the balance between innovation and access.
Monica, would you like to take the first one and then Dan the second?
Yes. So the issue of exit strategies. I think this is obviously a challenge for an organization like MSF. I think that this is, I would say definitely the organization has matured in its thinking in the last decade. One of the things we are seeing, of course, is, you know, people often say MSF is very vertical and does its own thing. I mean, you will find much in more and more MSF projects, we have very close collaborations with the Ministry of Health, like you saw presented earlier today. In Pakistan, sorry, I can't pronounce that. But then we also have projects that go on for long periods of time as well. We also realize that we have to commit and work in these projects in order even to achieve our own specific objectives. And then there are the situations where we come in for a specific intervention for an emergency, for a crisis, and we have to come in because there is an acute need. And then the question is, how do we get out of these situations? And I think we should stop blackmailing ourselves as an organization to say all the onus is on us to take the responsibility, because we were came in because there was a humanitarian situation and something had to be done. Well, that's just not acceptable to keep blaming ourselves. Other people have to take responsibility in this. And MSF does as well. They have to think constructively on exit strategies. But who are the people who are really responsible? I think that's the fundamental question. And I think there's also a lot of advocacy that needs to be done and is done within the organization on this issue of handover. And sometimes, unfortunately, it is not successful. And that's the best response I can give, in maybe within the position that I'm doing as well. I'm not directly connected with operations anymore on a day-to-day basis. But I can't say more on that. But I would like to emphasize that we should never stop ourselves from intervening because of this reason to think we can't find an exit strategy as well. I think that's also a very difficult situation that we should avoid.
Thanks, Manik. Dan, on USG, U.S. government.
Yeah, so I think, you know, there's clearly, when you think about advocacy in that general area, I mean, I like to think about diversity and innovation and consistency and voice. And I think the more consistently we can get the voice out and different people coming from different aspects with different thoughts on innovation can come together, but then go out with a single voice. I mean, I think that's clearly going to be much more powerful, and I think that's an area that there's room for improvement.
Yes, Rola.
Can I just say something? I think really MSF has to take responsibility. I talked about when I used to be in love with MSF. The way
Are you
MSF,
out of love now? Did you fall out of love?
Yes, I fell out of love the way they left Nigeria. Oh. They
Can we have a reunion? A reunion today?
But well, I think I just might. I mean, otherwise I won't be sitting here. I guess I have friends in house now, and they're trying to paint a better picture for me. But frankly, I think MSF needs to take responsibility. You don't go into a country, give life-saving medications, and then walk away without a backup plan and say the country should deal with it. That is totally irresponsible. And I say this because otherwise, when you go, it looks like all you've done is a cheap publicity stunt. And what it means is next time, some people put their neck on the line. Some people attended meetings with MSF. We attended rallies. We had, what's it called now? You had advocacy meetings. And you picketed, you did all of those things because you believed in a cause. Then when you need them the most, they walk away. What it means is when next a new person comes in, you have blocked that way for them. So I think you have to look beyond. I understand you need to have an exit strategy, but you have to plan it well. And you have to take responsibility. And if you need to knock yourself on the head, knock yourself on the head to get it right, frankly. Because you let people down in country, and you really leave a bad taste in our mouth for the new ones who come in.
We'll take the next two questions.
Hi, Judith Rios from the MSF Access Campaign in New York. Thank you so much for the very interesting panel and the honesty of this panel. I think it's a very important panel to talk about priorities. There's been a lot of conversation about money and about funding and about which diseases get funding, which disease doesn't get funding. I think that's very important, and it's been a very deep discussion. But there are other things that are important when we think about prioritization and what business model and what research and development strategy we choose. So putting money on the table, as the Gates Foundation has done, and hopefully the Brazilian government will increasingly done, is important. But what project you decide to fund and what research and development environment you decide to fund is equally important. So when the Gates Foundation, for example, decides to design and fund a mechanism like the advanced market commitment that for many, including for MSF, it has some problems of designs and is seen as an overpay to some pharmaceutical companies, basically a big subsidy to some pharmaceutical companies for the introduction of some vaccines in developing countries, is a decision that is not a neutral decision. It creates norms, creates a precedent, and it creates a direction on the way research and development is done. So my question to the Gates Foundation and to the Brazilian government is, how do you consider, one of the principles that has been put on the table in this conversation that the CWG is part of it, how do you see the principle of the linkage? When you put money on the table, and that's very welcome, we need more money on research and development, how you consider which business models and which research and development models are you going to choose? And how do you see the principle of the linkage? How do you see about the Gates Foundation and the Brazilian government supporting the implementation of specific linkage projects that are relevant for the needs of the countries that we're working on? Thanks.
Carlos, did you get that?
I thought that the problem was the translation, but I can try.
Carlos, I could use one of those myself, so I don't know.
I was worried about this.
I will try, and this will be a good test. And I think essentially, and sorry if I'm paraphrasing or if I missed the point, essentially the question was about the strategy you choose for delinkage. In other words, delinking the costs of R&D with the final access to the product, delinking R&D costs from price. How do you choose the right strategies for managing that delinkage? Is that more or less right?
Yes, more or less.
Yes? Okay. It is the key question. I will have, I will give you some aspects of the problem. First of all, I think you have to assume, in Brazil you have to assume that the universal care, universal access is a political priority. It is in our constitution. I am very happy that WHO assumed this strategy. It's a political strategy that I will not have technology for the poor and technology for the rich. This is very profound perspective. In concrete terms, I think that we have to remember that competition is very good for innovation and to have more options, not only few options. Then more countries, more companies, more arrangements is very good to affordable technology. Our problem nowadays is not only our problem. UK is with the similar problems of affordable technology. USA is with the same problem. Then my key message is reduce asymmetry. Monopoly, oligopoly is not good for innovation. It's not good to have many options to choose. I think this is the key message that Brazil is bringing to this meeting. We want to participate not only as a donator or a receptor of money or medicines. Pills and mobile phones will not solve health problems. When Morel here presents our experience in Africa, it's not to show we are opening a factory. No, it's another view of cooperative and of interaction with a country, a respectful relationship that we agree that they are capable to develop by themselves. I think that each one that is in this table are on the same side. I've been working very much with Doctors Without Borders, with Gates Foundation, with WHO, but we must not lose this perspective, this broad perspective, that health is not a problem of pills, equipment, and mobile phones. It's a more broad problem. And open the innovation system, not to close to 20 companies and to 5 countries, but open it. It would be very good to link innovation to health needs. And my final message, that the science and technology agenda nowadays is a central part of the health agenda. That's why I think that we can think that it's an additional aspect of the health agenda. The health authorities, WHO, must discuss intellectual property, not only follow the organization of OMC, World Trade Organization, because it's a key aspect of health. Then I think I will not answer the question with details, but the key idea is more competition, more options, and direct science and technology to help needs. It's possible because the health market is very big, and we have the instruments to direct the innovation to help needs. We don't have, I think, the political decision to do that.
Thank you. I think we've got about 5 minutes, and I want to try and get these last two questions in and get brief responses. So, Dan, you're off the hook in responding to the Gates Foundation and the Advanced Market Commitment, unless we have a few seconds at the end. Take both questions.
It was me.
Great.
Great.
Go ahead. Can you keep your question short? Very short.
Very short. All right. Yes. Eloan Pinheiro, former director of Farmanguinhos, the Joto Cruz Foundation. My question is to Carlos Gadelha. I heard an agreement was signed with the NGI and Fiocruz to help R&D in neglected in Brazil. For me, it's important to know why the government decided, why the Minister of Health decided to put money in neglected disease and also finance the NGI.
And the other question?
I think for me, I wanted to hear, Hirenisa Suleiman, TB activist. For me, I wanted to hear, I was yearning to hear innovative ideas, particularly from the community. I come from Kenya, and we in Kenya, in as much as we do have local pharmaceutical manufacturers, we have to import all our product developers from India, because our syllabus is about 4 decades old. And so there is no way that we will ever develop our new drugs ourselves. And that is a barrier to innovation. And I was also yearning to hear from the community in terms of how you're preparing for the new drugs, particularly the new TB drugs, learning from the other counterparts. And so I was waiting to hear innovative ideas from you. And I think for me, that was lacking.
Excellent. I'm going to throw that to the panel in general. Quick, rapid-fire responses, innovative ideas for developing local capacity for local R&D. Any thoughts?
Well, there are initiatives. Andy, who has been incubated at one time by TDR, has now centers of excellence on the continent and tries to drive the innovation of new medicines and diagnostic in collaboration with many partners. So there are initiatives, and indeed many African countries want to be part of innovation in the pharmaceutical sector.
Dan, what's the foundation thinking on transfer, tech transfer to low-income countries?
Well, I just want to also state that we recognize that, you know, it would be advantageous to have manufacturers in the geographies that we're trying to serve. And to that point, we are looking at a variety of different options. We've had discussions with a variety of different companies to try to do that, recognizing it's not a quick fix. You can build a factory, but then you have to have the workers. And so I think it's really thinking through that whole process of how does that happen? How do you train the people as well?
Rulake Manike, any last thoughts?
Okay, so apologies on not hearing about the preparing communities for the new TB treatment. I think that was a session before now, but I am myself, my colleague and I are very willing to speak with you after this session and address whatever concern you have. I'm Nigerian, she's Kenyan, we work in the communities, and we will be willing to do that with you.
Last thoughts, Manika?
Yes, I think it's a good question, particularly for the TB issue. It's a fundamental question now on how we're going to move forward and use these drugs responsibly, what's the best regimen we need to use, and more importantly, what's the terms of access for these drugs in the short to medium term future. And I think this is where you do need to have a sense of much more coordination. I mean, I think a lot of people are asking these questions. I know there has been some discussions even at WHO of trying to think of ways forward. But I do actually think that we're going to have to end up doing a lot more work to optimize these drugs and get to use them in the best way possible. And that's why I said at the very beginning, it's not going to happen in 1 or 2 or 3 years' time. We're not going to have something we can scale up quickly. And to me, that's part of the failure of the system.
And Carlos, I introduced you last, so you get the last word, but a short word. Thank you. We have 2 minutes.
Okay, 2 minutes is enough. First, I think that answering my colleague from Kenya, that always when we donate a pill or a medicine or a device, think about that we are in the knowledge society in the 21st cycle, and we must change, exchange, and cooperate in knowledge and technology. This is the long-term strategy to solve this problem. If without that, in the next decade, we will be here discussing other neglected diseases and the other neglected population. Then I think the broad idea is that we must discuss the asymmetries that has in the knowledge and technology in our world. The second one is that, only to answer Eloan, but not talking a lot, is that we launch a program with $20 million involving Brazilian government and our development bank with DNDA to stimulate, to support innovation with global health perspective in this year. It's completely new, and it shows that we must and you can act now. This is my key message. You must and you can act now. And I have a paper, a Lancet paper from 2002, 10 years ago, and the same questions are here. Okay.
I think that's a fantastic point to end on, and the notion of building a knowledge economy that sets us up for the future and for the future health challenges, I think is a fantastic point to end on. I want to thank the panel for their openness, for their insights, for their grace and their humour. Please give them a great round of applause.